Hello everyone, welcome to the second lecture about enhanced sampling methods. Today I'm going to talk about umbrella sampling. Let's suppose we want to investigate a process with a high energy barrier by molecular dynamics. For example, we want to simulate the reaction A to B, and this is the potential energy profile along the reaction coordinate which drives the system. So as you can see, there is a high energy barrier for going from A to B. So that means, as we have seen in a previous lecture, that if we run conventional molecular dynamics starting here in the region of the reactants, the system will be trapped here forever, because it's very unlikely that the system is able to jump this very high energy barrier. So this will be a very, very slow process. So we need an efficient sampling technique in order to accelerate the dynamics, because we want to populate the region of the products, this region B, and also, and maybe even more important, we also want to populate the pathway which connects the reactant region with the products region, because this pathway represents the reaction mechanism. In this lecture, we are going to assume that we know the reaction coordinate. In other words, we know the coordinate that drives the reaction, because umbrella sampling is only useful in this situation when we know the reaction coordinate. Okay, so here we have the potential energy profile of our reaction along the reaction coordinate he. Of course, we don't know this potential energy profile before running the simulation, but we are representing it here just for simplicity. But as I said, we don't know this in advance. So the first thing we need to know is to divide the reaction coordinate into several windows. So something we need to know is the range of the reaction coordinate that we want to simulate. If we don't know it, then it's very hard to use umbrella sampling. But if we know the reaction coordinate and we know more or less the range we want to simulate the reaction, then we can use umbrella sampling. Okay. So, as I said, we split the reaction coordinate in several windows, and then let's go to window number one, and we apply an artificial potential represented in red on top of the real potential, which is represented in blue. So, in total, we have that the bias potential is equal to the real potential, which is called here unbiased. This is why we have here a U as a superscript, plus the artificial potential, which is represented in red. Usually, we use a harmonic function, which depends on the reaction coordinate, as artificial potential. And this artificial potential is needed because this potential will keep the system inside the window number one during the molecular dynamics simulation. So now, with this bias potential, we run molecular dynamics, and as I said, our system will be trapped here in this region until the simulation finishes. So we are running a standard molecular dynamics simulation inside the window number one. So here we have these two equations. Equations 3 and 4 are the velocity Berlet equations that we have seen in a previous lecture, where we can compute the coordinates and the velocities of every atom in our system from previous coordinates and velocities from a previous time step. And here, in order to solve these equations, we are using the bias potential. That means we are using the real potential plus the artificial one. Okay, when the molecular dynamics simulation is finished in the window number one, we change the equilibrium value of the reaction coordinate here. So in this case, we increase the equilibrium value. And then we go from window number one to the window number two. And now, with this new value of the equilibrium reaction coordinate, we run a molecular dynamics simulation here in the second window. And then we repeat this procedure, increasing several times the value of the reaction coordinate. And then we run molecular dynamics simulations for each of these windows. So at the end of the process, what we have is several molecular dynamics simulations along the reaction coordinate range that we want to simulate. Okay, after finishing all the simulations, let's analyze the window number one. So if we analyze the coordinates of this trajectory in the window number one, we can compute the probability distribution along the reaction coordinate for this particular window. This is very easy to do because we can just count the number of times that the system visit a particular reaction coordinate value. And then we can get this probability distribution for the window number one. Okay, we can do the same also for the window number two here, and also for all the other windows. And what we get is the probability distribution along the full reaction coordinate range. Here we are writing the probability distribution B, because this is the bias probability distribution, because we are running a bias simulation using these artificial potentials to keep the system inside each window. Once we know the bias probability distribution, we can compute the free energy profile along the reaction coordinate. Usually, this is also called the potential of mean force. In a minute, we are going to see the equations which relate the bias probability distribution, which is the one we get from our simulations, with the unbiased free energy profile, which is the real free energy profile. One important parameter here is the value of the force constant of the artificial potential, because the choice of this value will determine the quality of our simulations. For example, if we choose a very small force constant, the simulation will not drive the system over the barrier, because if this constant is very small, then the bias potential will be almost equal to the unbiased one. So we are running basically the simulation in our real potential, where we have a very high energy barrier. So we will not be able to overcome this barrier. However, if we use a very large force constant, we will get very narrow probability distributions. Here is the graphical representation. If we use a very large force constant in our artificial potential, we get this harmonic potential with a very high curvature. So the system will be trapped here in this very narrow region, and this means we will get this kind of probability distributions, very narrow probability distributions. And we have seen in our previous lecture about enhanced sampling that we need a very good overlap between neighboring probability distributions in order to get an accurate free energy profile. So if we have this situation, if we have this kind of holes between probability distributions of neighboring windows, we will get a very bad free energy profile. So what we have to do is to increase the number of windows, because only in this situation, only with a very large number of windows, we will get overlap between neighboring probability distributions. But the bad side of this is we need a very large computational time, because we have to simulate a lot of windows. So it is important to choose in a proper manner the value of the force constant of the artificial potential and also the number of windows. And the only way to do this choice is just trying several values and running short simulations and computing the overlap between neighboring distributions. And when we get a good overlap, then we choose this force constant and this number of windows. Let's see now how to compute the free energy from the umbrella sampling simulations. If we are running our simulations in the canonical ensemble, so with the number of particles, volume, and temperature constant, then we can compute the Helmholtz energy from the probability distribution following equation 6. So here we have the Helmholtz energy is equal to minus the Boltzmann constant, temperature, and then the logarithm of the probability distribution. Remember, we have here the superscript U to indicate that these are unbiased properties, so the real ones. We can also get a similar equation if we are running the simulations in the MPT ensemble or in the isothermal isobaric ensemble, where now instead of the Helmholtz energy, we get the free energy from equation 7. These two equations are the same, but we are just running the simulations in different ensembles. Now the probability distribution can be computed from the Boltzmann distribution. In particular, we need to integrate out all degrees of freedom but the reaction coordinate. Here we get equation number 8, where we have here the exponential of minus the unbiased potential energy of the system. And here we integrate over all the coordinates but the reaction coordinate. This equation, we are using the Kronecker delta in order to compute the probability distribution for a given reaction coordinate value. So in this way, when the reaction coordinate is equal to the value we want, then the delta Kronecker is equal to 1. And if this is not the case, then it's equal to 0. So the problem here is that we need to compute the unbiased probability distribution to compute the unbiased free energy. But what we know from our umbrella sampling simulations is the bias probability distribution. This means that we need to find a relation between the bias and the unbiased distributions. So the bias probability distribution can be computed in the same way as the unbiased one, just using equation 8, but we need to add the artificial potential to the equation. So this is now equation 8, but with this, with the modification here. So now in the exponential, we don't have only the unbiased potential, but we have the unbiased potential plus the artificial potential that we are using to keep the system inside each of the windows. The same we have with the same thing here in this other term. Okay, so now what we are doing here from equation 9 to the following equation is just to separate here the exponential of this sum into the product of these two exponentials. So this is a very easy step. And now, since the bias potential depends only on the reaction coordinate, and if you remember, in this integral here, we are integrating out all the coordinates, but not the reaction coordinate, we can write outside the integral this exponential, the exponential of minus the bias potential. Because as I said, the bias potential depends only on the reaction coordinate. Now let's compute the unbiased potential, the unbiased distribution, sorry, over the bias distribution using equations 8 and 10. So this is just the result. Here I just wrote down equations 8 and 10. So this division here. And now, as you can see, these two terms are the same, so they cancel out. So we can delete these two terms and we get equation number 11. Now, the only thing we are doing when going from equation 11 to equation 12 is just move this bias distribution from the left side to the right side. So this is the only change. And also here, we are separating this exponential of this sum into the product of two exponentials. And if you look here at this integral in equation 12, this is just the definition of the ensemble average of this exponential. We have also seen in a previous lecture that the average of a particular property A can be computed from this equation. So we have here the integral of the property A, which depends on the coordinates Q, multiplied by this Boltzmann factor, and this is divided by the partition function. And this is exactly what we have here in the equation 12. But instead of A, what we have is the exponential of minus beta multiplied by the artificial potential. So we can rewrite equation 12 in the following way. Instead of this integral, we can write just the ensemble average of this exponential here. Now replace equation 13 into equation 7 and we get the following equation. Now the free energy, the unbiased free energy, is just minus 1 over beta multiplied by the logarithm of the bias probability distribution, this exponential, and the ensemble average of this other exponential. Then we can develop this logarithm in the sum of several logarithms and we get equation 15. And equation 15 can be simplified in this way, and we get equation 16. Finally, we can define here a factor f, so this is just a definition, and we can write the equation 16 in this way. So as you can see, we can compute the unbiased free energy of the reaction from the bias probability distribution, which remember is the distribution we get from the umbrella sampling simulations, and also from the artificial potential that we know, and also from this constant F. What we are going to do is to use equation 17 for each of the windows we are splitting our reaction coordinates. So what we are going to compute the free energy for each individual window, following equation 18, which is exactly the same equation as the equation 17, but we are only adding this subscript I, indicating that we are computing the free energy for a particular window I. Now, the combination of each of these individual free energy terms into a global free energy along the reaction coordinate requires the computation of this factor f, of this constant f. And there are several approaches to compute this f. The most popular one is likely the so-called weighted histogram analysis method. So from the definition of f, from equation 16, we can write the following equation: minus beta multiplied by f is equal to the logarithm of the ensemble average of this exponential, which depends on the bias potential omega. Now we just move this logarithm to the left side as an exponential. We get the following equation, where here we will use again the definition of the ensemble average. So this ensemble average is equal to the integral of the unbiased probability distribution multiplied by this exponential. This is just a definition that we have already used before. And now the global distribution PU is computed from a weighted average of the distributions of the individual windows. So here is the equation. So the global distribution is just this summation, where NW is the number of windows, and here we have the unbiased probability distribution for each individual window multiplied by a weight. In order to compute this weight, we minimize the statistical error of the unbiased probability distribution. So this is the first condition. So we are here minimizing the error of the unbiased distribution in order to compute these weights. And also a second condition we need to apply is that the sum of all the weights is equal to 1, so we are normalizing the weights. So using these two conditions leads to the following equations. So we are going not to develop all the demonstration, all the formalism. You can follow it in this paper. So here I'm going to show only the final result. So the first equation we get by using these two conditions is that the weights are equal to a parameter A divided over the sum of all the parameters. So remember, NW is the number of windows, so we will have a parameter A for each of the windows. We are splitting the reaction coordinate, and each of these A's follows equation 25, where Ni is the number of steps sampled for window I, and then we have beta, which is the inverse of the Boltzmann constant multiplied by temperature, the artificial potential here, and F is the constant we want to compute. So in summary, the one algorithm works in the following way. First, our goal, remember, is to compute the F constant here using equation 20. And in equation 20, we need also to know the unbiased probability distribution, which can be written as a linear combination of the unbiased probability distribution of each of the windows. And here, these weights are computed using equation 24 and equation 25. In equation 24, we see that the weights depends on this constant A, and this constant A depends at the same time on F. So that means that we want to compute f, but f depends on a, and a depends on f again. So in other words, we need to solve the equations in a self-consistent manner until the result is converged. So in summary, if we want to run an umbrella sampling simulation, first we need to define the reaction coordinate, and after the definition we need to split the reaction coordinate into a number of windows. Then we need to run a conventional molecular dynamics simulation for each of these windows, and in order to keep the system inside each of the windows, we need to apply a bias potential. We need to apply an artificial potential, which usually is a harmonic potential which depends on the reaction coordinate. Then, after running the simulations, we can compute the bias probability distribution for each of our windows. And finally, we can compute the potential of mean force, or the free energy along the reaction coordinate, which is the same thing, from the bias distributions, for example, using the weighted histogram analysis method. That's it. Thank you very much for watching, and see you in the next lecture.